Can't you get any of that that music that they would use in either Dragnet or, you know, some, you know, bulletin from the 50s or something?
Okay, I'll put that in. Late breaking news, Donald Trump revealed highly classified intelligence information to Russia. With us is Howard Klein, reporting to us from Los Angeles. How are you there?
I'm doing okay. How about you?
Actually, you're in Los Feliz.
Los Angeles. Los Feliz is part of Los Angeles. It's just not part of Hollywood.
Right. I'm going to play devil's advocate. I was visiting my mother and my sister, and we were having a nice Mother's Day, and they were going on and on about Trump.
And just everybody.
And just to keep the conversation going, I said, so what? I just kept saying, so what? And this late-breaking news about highly classified intelligence. Let me just play devil's advocate. We're just learning that Trump met with Sergey Lavrov, the Russian foreign minister, in the White House last week, and he revealed highly classified intelligence about some ISIS plot.
Right. So not just, Lavrov, which, according to the White House pictures that were released, it was only Lavrov. But when the Russians released the pictures, you noticed there was this big fat guy who was even fatter than Trump, and that turned out that was the spymaster for the Kremlin for all of the Western Hemisphere, and that is the ambassador to Washington, Kislyak. I mean, he whose name everyone has probably heard, because he's the one that literally met with every Trump campaign person that ever existed, including Jared Kushner. So he's the spy master for the Kremlin, for the Western Hemisphere. He's the main guy. And he was in this meeting, too, and Trump tried to hide that. If you'll remember, they didn't allow any Western journalists in. They allowed Russian journalists in, and the Russian journalists then released a picture of Trump with Kislyak.
Kislyak is the guy Flynn met with.
Everybody met with him.
Right.
Flynn met with him. As I said, Kushner-in-law met with him. Carter Page met with him. Manafort met with him. Everybody met with him. It was almost like he was like telling Trump who he could and couldn't hire. He's the head Russian spy for all of the Western Hemisphere, and Trump goes and tells him and Lavrov very, very, very highly classified information, which was described by the reporter for the New York Post who broke the story as the kind of information that you need a secret code to even read the information. That's how highly classified it is. And basically the reason for that was because it came from an American ally who was not interested in Russia knowing that they were passing this information along for whatever reason. It could be very serious reasons. And by Trump revealing it, he potentially put that ally in great danger. And that is a complete no-no.
And
not allowed on any level at all.
Who is the
and
ally?
This
Who's the
freak
ally?
Out everywhere among American intelligence services, but also among foreign intelligence services, to the point where the Israelis are now saying, you know, Trump is coming over there, and they have to be careful of anything they say to him going back to the Russians and then on to the Iranians or some other enemy of Israel's.
Because I'm trying to get in the mind of a Trump supporter, and it's not that hard to get inside the mind of a Trump supporter since it's so empty. I'm going to say, isn't Russia our ally half the time in Syria? Isn't Russia our ally fighting ISIS?
No. Russia has its own national interests, and they are mostly divergent with American national interests. They have some, they're occasionally, certainly not half the time, not or close to that, the interests of the two countries will intersect. But that's rare, and certainly in Syria, I would say that isn't even like, you know, 2% of the time. The two countries are at odds with each other in Syria. And in terms of fighting ISIS, from what I can see, Russia, it's all with Russia. It's all talk and no action. I don't see them helping the United States fighting ISIS in any way, shape, or form. So the answer to your question,
okay,
in my opinion, no.
Okay, the news coming over the transom is that Trump disclose something to the Russians that, as you just said, one of our allies had this information about an ISIS plot, and he violated espionage etiquette by doing this, Donald Trump did.
Well, it's more than etiquette, but okay.
Are we overreacting? Isn't the entire intelligence community in the weeds waiting for the slightest mistake and just pouncing on Trump?
Yes. I don't think this was a slight mistake, though. This was a more major mistake than that. The fear is that since he doesn't read his intelligence briefings, and so they give, a normal president gets very detailed intelligence briefings. He doesn't want them. He wants basically charts and pictures and like a couple of paragraphs. He doesn't want big intelligence briefings, and he has made it clear that anything over one page will be thrown directly into the garbage. Mm-hmm. So basically, he gets these one-page summaries that have to have a chart or a picture, and then Kushner comes in and reads it to him, and while he's playing on his computer, his iPhone, whatever he uses, and he's not paying attention. And intelligence officials are saying that he doesn't understand the difference between classified, highly classified, top secret. He doesn't understand these things, and to him, it's none of the stuff that they give him is any different from what he hears Sean Hannity saying on Fox. It's all the same to him, and he just blabs it and runs his mouth as though it doesn't make any difference and there are no consequences, and they're all freaking out about it. And I don't think it's a little thing. I think it's a very big thing.
You think it's a big thing? Okay.
In the United States, who can get his hands on any piece of information and can do anything he wants with it, is a 70-year-old senile freak like Donald Trump.
Obviously, he's a mortal threat to the planet. I happen to sometimes think America is not being threatened by anybody, that we juice up the threats so the defense contractors can get all their money.
That's not untrue. That what you're saying isn't untrue, but the two things shouldn't negate each other. And there are threats on one level or another to the United States. And, just as an example, I mean, several adversaries of America, including Russia, have long advocated the international trading community ditch the dollar and go to another currency. Or another means of selling up bills. That would be, cost the United States trillions of dollars. So is that an adversary? Is that a threat to the United States? Yes, and it's one of dozens and dozens of dozens that are different from, nuclear bombs dropping on an American city.
Would you say that maybe we don't need to be worrying as much as they want us to about ISIS and Al-Qaeda and Russia, that Russia, Crimea, notwithstanding, that Russia is not as big a threat to our safety as...
Well, it is a threat, but, I mean, not necessarily a threat in terms of bombing us. There's other kinds of threats, like I just tried to...
Yeah, but you have this...
I don't even consider Crimea... Personally, I don't consider Crimea like the kind of threat that it's been painted to be, because in reality, Crimea really was part of Russia, and they just sort of made a bureaucratic transfer to make the Ukrainians happy at one point in the, I don't know, the 1960s or something. And the people of Crimea, from all I could tell, are just perfectly happy being part of Russia prefer it to being part of Ukraine.
4 years from now, is it conceivable that they installed a complete idiot into the Oval Office who nobody trusts, therefore he can't lead us into war? He's an isolationist. He's so irresponsible. The minute he tries to send troops somewhere, everybody, McMaster, Mattis, everybody, is good. No, we're not going to war.
Did you read Barbara Tuchman's classic book, The Guns of August?
I skimmed it. It was a little too hard for me to read. But I know that Kennedy handed that out to all his advisors during
It's a brilliant book and a very well worth reading. And it's not a complicated book or a difficult read or anything. It's very enjoyable, as a matter of fact. You might try it because you know you're in a state now where you probably get more pleasure out of it than whenever you just skimmed it. In any case, there was one of the major points of it was that these heads of government don't try to start a war. That's not what they don't set out to have a war. They blunder into it with no intention of doing it. And she's talking about World War One, the most disastrous war in the history of mankind, and no one wanted that war. No one thought it was going to happen, but just one boob after another just, you know, made foolish mistakes, and that is more the kind of a threat that Trump would be in terms of a war than him plotting a war. Because you're right, no one is going to let Trump get away with starting a war. His people around him would stop that. The real danger is because he's such an imbecile that he'll just, you know, stumble into one and people won't be around to clean up his mess fast enough before something disastrous happens with, you know, North Korea or Russia or China or any kind of adversary, and that's a danger. I mean, you know, Trump, you know, there's a lot of scuttlebutt that says that Trump has kind of accepted the fact that he's not really in the chain of command. As long as he can make believe he is, he doesn't have to really be part of the chain of command. So that, if that's really true, I mean, I feel a little bit better about that, but I don't feel great about it. I would rather have there's a reason that we have civilians running the military.
Yeah. I'm just thinking.
Well, it should be.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about God's joke. I mean, things are bad. There's no question. And this is terrifying. And we're on the precipice of fascism, although I don't think he's smart enough. Well, how smart was Mussolini and how smart was Hitler? They weren't that bright.
And it has a lot to do not just with them, but also with people around them. And Trump does have some very dangerous people around him. Although, you know, there's all sorts of rumors that he's going to fire Bannon. But Bannon is certainly capable of leading the country into a state of fascism, which I'm sure is his what he wants to do.
Going back to Russia, Mother's Day. I asked my sister, I asked my mother, yes, it's bad, but what did Russia do that's so wrong? They hacked the DNC and they released some files and embarrassed Hillary. Is that really that bad? And out of
But you know that was only the tip of the iceberg. They did a lot more than that.
Well, they colluded maybe with Trump's campaign to do opposition research. Is that a possibility?
I think that they spent many millions of dollars on setting up operations to deceive low IQ American voters with all of this fake news through, you know, hundreds of thousands of fake Twitter accounts and websites and news reporting operations that don't exist, and you know, that doesn't work on people with three-digit IQs. Not that that means someone is brilliant, but you know, when you look at the Trump voters, just look at them, talk to one. It works on them,
right? So whose fault is that? That's more our fault than it is Russia's.
Well, it may be. I mean, you know, getting rid of civics classes from I mean, when I was a kid, we had civics classes. They don't anymore. You know, and downgrading education. I mean, you know, the Republicans, at every opportunity, they do everything they can to downgrade education because they know very well that their party depends on a poorly educated electorate that has no capacity for critical thinking.
If Putin gave money to some of the candidates, that would be obviously illegal.
How about using the money on behalf of some of the candidates? I mean, you know, in France, where he could get away with giving money. I guess there's no law against it. They gave, I think, a $10 million to Le Pen. In this country, theoretically, you can't do that, although there are ways to launder money to candidates, which apparently has happened, and that's part of an investigation. And that's why we need a nonpartisan, independent investigation that can't be controlled by Paul Ryan or by Mitch McConnell or by the Justice Department. It's got to be an independent investigation. And one of the things that everyone is trying to get to is Trump's business dealings with the Russians. You know, a member of Congress last night called me and was telling me that the way he thinks, from what he's read, that they did it was by overpaying on real estate. So in other words, if a piece of real estate is worth $2 million and they give $20 million, that's a way to funnel money into Trump. Mm. And he said that that's been, that has happened many, many times.
Right. In Florida, there was a mansion that Trump
that's
bought.
One. That was one. He was, this guy was talking specifically about New York real estate.
Hmm. We'll go back to shredding the safety net. I know you.
Well, you brought up the giving money. I mean,
I want Trump impeached. I want him gone.
What's the difference between impeached and gone?
Well, he's not going to get impeached. He's not going to get impeached.
Is he going to get gone?
I don't think he's going to get gone. I think they're going to keep him. Isn't he servicing the people who put him there by creating this clown show?
He's certainly not going to get impeached while the Republicans are in control of Congress. That's for sure. So if there's any kind of impeachment, we're talking about, after 2019, after the midterms.
Other than the fact that you despise Trump, how bad is this? Is it truly a constitutional crisis, or do we just hate him, you know, so much that we're creating things to get upset about?
Well, can you accept that the two things can exist at the same time?
Yeah.
I would say that that's probably the case.
If he gets caught, what do you think it's going to be? The money, the Russian money following that money?
Yes, that is what I think.
Okay. Speaking of money, we have a budget that's being negotiated, and you write that they're going to be shredding the social safety net. Is there even a social safety net left to shred?
Not much left, but there is some left. So remember, Trump plans on massive tax cuts for the very wealthy, like really massive. Just as an example, getting rid of the estate tax the estate tax. If you die and you have $6 million, the federal taxes on that is zero, nothing. But if you have $6 billion, then there's some real taxes on that. They want to get rid of that. That's a big deal. So how do you fill in the gaps in the budget, which the Republicans in Congress are insisting on? Trump, of course, doesn't care. As far as he's concerned, he would run up, the most red ink in the history of the universe. It doesn't matter to him. But the Republicans feel that they can't do that. They say if you're going to, they'll do it to some extent, but they don't want to do it to the kind of extent that Trump wants. So aside from cutting taxes for the rich, which he plans to do in a very major way, and cutting corporate taxes, he also plans to, so in other words, reducing revenues, he also plans to spend giant amounts of money, on the military. He really wants to build up the military in a very big way, even though the American military is bigger than the next six countries combined. Who cares? He still wants to build it up. And he wants to build that silly wall, which is, estimates range. Certainly the average is around $1 trillion, although it could even be much more than $1 trillion.
To build the wall?
And to put that into the budget.
I'm sorry, did you say it's $1 trillion to build the wall?
Sorry?
You said it's $1 trillion to build the wall?
Well, the average is it could be much more. I mean, some people say it's $3 trillion. Some people say it's more like, $100 billion. So, I don't know what it's going to cost. But I'm just saying the average is around $1 trillion.
Okay.
Or I think I read the average was $1.3 trillion.
Jesus.
No one knows exactly what the wall is going to be. and where it's going to go, and is it going to cover this area, or are they going to leave it out, or are they going to leave that area out? I mean, so people don't know for sure, but you know, they did an estimate based on, you know, per I don't know if it was per, it wasn't per mile, it was a smaller amount of per, it was smaller than a mile, and it was some, it was atrocious, the millions of dollars just for it. I mean, well, forget about the fact that it's ineffective, but you know, the point is that they're going to spend a lot of money on foolish things, and the Republicans have agreed now that they are going to put these things into the budget. They're angry that the Democrats made fun of them for signing the continuing resolution that didn't include any of Trump's priorities. So now they're going to include all of Trump's priorities. So the question then comes, where do they get the money for this stuff? And since Trump has said he does, what he said is that he would have no cuts to Social Security, no cuts to Medicare, and no cuts to Medicaid. They've already cut $880 billion out of Medicaid over 10 years. So, but he's apparently holding firm on no cuts to Social Security and Medicare, at least for now. So then you say to yourself, where do you get the money? Where is he going to get the money to pay for the silly wall, for the arms buildup, and for the other priorities that he wants? And the answer to that question is, there is no place else to get it from except for cutting spending for poor people, social safety net, as you refer to it. That's what the Republicans are up to now. So I did a post about it this morning that includes some interesting reactions from a guy, you know, labor union activist in Paul Ryan's district, who's likely to run against Paul Ryan, a guy named Randy Bryce. He's likely to be the Democratic candidate against Ryan. Now, the DCCC, the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee, doesn't want to run anybody against Paul Ryan. They never have. They've never run anybody. They've sabotaged every Democrat who's tried to run against Paul Ryan. And they're very, very nervous now because this guy is a grassroots kind of hero. He's, when you think about Paul Ryan's district, it went for Clinton. I mean, it went for Trump against Clinton. And Randy Bryce is like the exact opposite of Clinton. Every reason that anyone in that district had to vote against Hillary Clinton will make them embrace Randy Bryce. This is an iron worker with a huge handlebar mustache. And, you know, he's the kind of guy that you meet in a bar having a drink, and then he goes home to his wife and kids. A great guy. And he's going to take on Ryan now. And the DCCC is flipping out over it. But anyway, he was one of the people.
When you say flipping out, they're angry that he...
They don't want someone running against Ryan. It's against their policy. They oppose people running against Paul Ryan. Their perspective is it's going to take a lot of energy, and we're not going to win anyway, and they don't want the resources going in that direction, and they don't want people to have false hopes that we could beat Ryan when we can't. The fact of the matter is they're going after much more difficult districts than Paul Ryan's district. Obama won Paul Ryan's district in his first run. He beat him. He beat McCain there. Wow. I'm not saying it's an easy race. It's not. It's a hard race. But if you don't do it and you don't try, you never find out. And now Hillary won all these districts in Texas that the DCCC has never ever tried to win. Now they're trying to win all of them, but it's the first time they've ever worked in these districts. So you don't win the first time. So you know, if you try one time and you don't win, you learn how to do it better the next time. Then you can try it again the next time. But there has to be a first time, and the DCCC doesn't believe in first times.
Do you think Pelosi cut a deal with Ryan over something and said, okay, if you give me this, we won't run anybody against you?
It was long before Ryan when they wouldn't run anybody against John Boehner. They sabotaged every candidate who tried to run against John Boehner. I mean, we at Blue America, we worked very closely with this guy, again, a labor union activist named Justin Kasuli. And Justin ran a great campaign But the DCCC did everything they could to sabotage him over and over and over again. And they do that with Republican leaders. All Republican leaders, they always try to protect them. And it's the darndest thing because the Republicans don't return the favor. True, they don't go after Pelosi. But, you know, I mean, look, what do you think the percentage was that Trump got in Pelosi's district? I just want to show you how blue that district is.
Well, I know it's San Francisco. It's, I think,
7%.
Wow,
that's how that was what Trump's total was in San Francisco, 7%. So, you know, so we don't really need the Republicans not to pursue Nancy Pelosi. Paul Ryan is in a 50-50 district. Pelosi is in a 90-10 district. They don't go after Steny Hoyer, but he's in a completely blue district. So I don't know what the deal is. I don't know why there is a deal. And certainly the Democrats don't go after Republican committee leaders, but the Democrats don't go after Republican committee chairman, but the Republicans go after Democratic committee chairman and occasionally defeat them. So if there is a deal, the Democrats are getting a very, very poor end of that deal.
Hmm. Healthcare. They're saying now that it's going to get killed in the Senate, but a month ago...
Well, no one is really saying it's going to get killed. They're just saying that they're hoping that the Senate is going to change it and make it less unpalatable. And, you know, but the question then becomes, if they send something back that's less unpalatable, will the Freedom Caucus then say, no, we won't vote for it? I mean, how unpalatable can they make it before they lose Freedom Caucus? So, for example, two senators, at least two Republican senators have said they're not going to vote for a bill that defunds Planned Parenthood. So both Susan Collins and Lisa Murkowski from Alaska, Susan Collins from Maine, they both say if that's in there, they're not going to vote for it. Okay, well, let's say they're being honest and they're not going to. What happens then? Because if that bill goes back, if the healthcare bill goes back to the House with a with that taken out, with that provision to defund Planned Parenthood out, then the Freedom Caucus has already said they're not going to vote for it. So that is something that I don't know how it gets worked out. I don't know how that can happen. But you know, there are a lot of Republicans that are determined to make it happen somehow. I don't know how.
Before you go, what are the races we should be watching?
Well, there are two races coming up very, very quickly in the next couple of weeks. First of all, there is the Montana at-large House seat because Ryan Zinke, the congressman from Montana, was named Trump's Interior Secretary. So his seat is open. And that is, people think, well, Montana is so red. Well, it's not really so red. Yes, Trump did very, very well against Hillary Clinton, but Hillary Clinton is exactly the wrong kind of candidate for Montana. If you had to say, you know, create a candidate that will have no chance in Montana whatsoever, you create Hillary Clinton. The Republicans couldn't have asked for someone better than her. But on that same day that Trump slaughtered her, in Montana, the Democratic governor beat the guy who's running for Congress right now in that district. He won. Bernie Sanders did really well in Montana. He beat Clinton by a lot, and I think he beat Clinton in almost every county. She won a couple, but Bernie really cleaned her clock. So the candidate who's running now for the Democrats, this guy named Rob Quist, who is I don't want to say a folk singer, but he's a folksy, really well-known singer, a professional, and he's gone to every little town in that state and been playing for years and years and years. And he's really well-liked and really well-known, and he's the Democratic candidate. And Bernie is going to be barnstorming the state with him on this coming Saturday and Sunday. So we'll see. He's been rising in the polls. He's still behind the Republican. They're spending a god-awful amount of money. The DCCC doesn't want to spend money in there, but they've been forced into spending a little. And then the other race in June that's really, really important is the one in Georgia, Georgia 6, to replace Tom Price, who's now the Secretary of Health and Human Services. And that pits Jon Ossoff, kind of a you know, kind of a moderate to liberal Democrat against a far-right Republican Trump shill named Karen Handel, just a complete pawn of Trump's. And the polling shows them neck and neck. I mean, the newest poll that came out yesterday had him leading her by 2 points.
Is Trump going to drag them down? Because Trump is at record
lows. Well,
that's
the idea, yes. I mean, yeah. I mean, Trump drag them down? So maybe. But he went to Atlanta. She refused to allow herself to be photographed with him. So there are no pictures anywhere of Handel and Trump. But Paul Ryan went also, and he's there again this week. And there are pictures of her with him. And remember, Paul Ryan is very, very toxic right now. You know, all the polling is showing that Paul Ryan is one of the most hated politicians in America. His approval rating is in the gutter, and no one likes him. In fact, in his own district, I didn't mention this, there was a poll that came out by PPP that showed that 51% of the people in the district think they would not vote for him again, and only 44% of the people in the district say he deserves another term. Hmm. So, and that's his own district where they know him and kind of like him, but around the rest of the country, they might not know that much about him, but they do know that he wrote the health care bill, or that it's his bill, basically. The Trump care certainly wasn't written by Trump. It was under the direction of Paul Ryan, and depending on which poll you read, that Trump care is liked by either 17% of the people or 23% of the people. But 23% of the people, the high number, is pretty bad. And that's what people know about Trump care, or about Paul Ryan. And he's in Karen Handel's district campaigning with her. I don't think that's going to help her. I mean, it helps with donors. They love Paul Ryan. But I don't think it helps with human beings.
Great. Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, and he writes the Down With Tyranny blog. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Talk to you next week.
Okay, thank you. Great job. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.